It's 12 o'clock on a Wednesday, and this is the Wizard Product Review. I'm Dave.
I'm Jazz.
You beat you to it.
I'm excitable.
Blammo, have your biscuit. There you go. You don't get any biscuits until we finish the show. Suddenly, I'm sensing a lot of guys out there have just got a little bit more interest in the Wizard Product Review right now. A bit like me today, I had to keep my eyes on the review pile. And first up was Chairs by Steve Seguin. Can you synopsisize Jazz? And by the way, we are going to have a chat with Jazz about what she's been up to and what she's got coming up in the future very, very soon, and get a woman's perspective on this stuff we call show.
Yeah.
All right, we'll discuss that later. But Chairs, can you synopsisize what actually happens during the routine?
Okay, in the performance, he gets, I think it's four guys.
Four guys
out of the audience. And there's a lot of tomfoolery and exciting sort of moves and things, which all lead to laughs, which is good.
Yeah.
And it's kind of a balancing act, but kind of like a, you know, like those team exercises you get in, I don't know, just team exercises.
Like a corporate, conference. Yeah.
Yeah. So
team building days. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's like he gets four up from the audience, and using their own bodies, he does this balancing act, which looks really interesting. It's really unusual to watch, and yeah, it's quite fun. It's very audience.
I think it's what's interesting here is that he doesn't have any props at all, and he has nothing to carry. He's just using the chairs that he finds at the event, and it is a great finale, isn't it? With very careful scripting, he gets a standing ovation at the end from the audience, and it literally just uses four guys from the audience.
Yeah, I mean, it's good that he doesn't have to bring any massive props, because usually for the end of an act, you have something big, don't you? So you end up having lots of props. And we
commented while we were watching it on quite a few occasions that it fills the stage very, very well.
Yeah.
And he's got this bit. I don't want to go too much into the script that Steve uses, because that's actually what the production company and Bill and Steve are actually selling. They're selling his script, which will get you these kind of guaranteed reactions. And as well as the DVD project, you get a book with it as well, which is quite nice. It makes it very easy to digest the product over a few days. But it fills the stage very, very well, because he gets four guys out, and he kind of implies that they're part of a circus troupe. They have to do a certain series of moves. Yeah. And there's no doubt that this brings the audience in. And you can imagine if you did this at a corporate event, people would be looking at it and they'd be getting very much involved.
Yeah, I mean, it's great if you have like the sort of the director of the company and other people, and it really gets people laughing along. And
it's when he does it and he's got the four chairs and he takes the chairs away, I actually still don't know how it can work.
It's
because people are saying, oh yeah, it's not, maybe it's just a juggling stunt, but even me, I'm looking at it and I'm thinking, how can that work?
How many people have we got in today? How many people should we try it?
try and set it up.
And
you're kind of still thinking about it afterwards, and you're thinking, how is that possible?
It's bizarre. It's very bizarre.
So I'm not at all surprised when Steve gets this huge reaction from it. And they can still like lift one leg and do the salute, the circle salute, while
like
they're
a,
in this position.
Thing,
wasn't it? he actually explains in the book. He was inspired by the Three Amigos.
Oh, was it?
Do you know that movie?
Yeah, I think so. I may have seen it.
It's years ago. Steve Martin, Sunday Martin Short, and that kind of thing. And they do all this at the end. It's not quite like that, but he explains it. A lot is covered in the DVD. And I want to kind of say that actually the fact that it's delivered in this way on this DVD and on this project actually gave me the confidence to probably try it at a conference. If I just read about it in a book, I don't think I'd have the confidence to try it, because Steve goes into so much detail of not only how to set your stage and how to present it, but how to ensure that you choose the right volunteers and make sure that it goes right. The health and safety side of it is all covered, and it gives you the confidence to actually try it. I think if I just saw a few pictures in a book or saw a quick clip on a video, I might think, do you know what? I'm not going to risk that. I might hurt somebody. They might do something wrong. I'm not going to take that chance. But the nice thing about this project is not only do you get the DVD, you get the book with it as well. And I think this is a really nice way to do a project, I think, because...
Well, it's all about the presentation with this,
yeah,
this piece. It's all about the packaging of the kind of four-person balancing act.
Yeah.
And the reactions were just so good. I didn't expect that kind of reaction from it, but I think because it involved people from the audience, that's what got everyone
It gets
of,
a standing ovation.
Yeah, it was quite surprising.
And the fact that I had the book... as well as the DVD. Because I think when you get a magic product these days, do you kind of stick the DVD on once and then you kind of try and remember it? And then, like, you might put the DVD in one more time.
Yeah, I think it depends on the routine. But
you never keep referring to the DVD, do you, in the same way that you can with a book? Whereas what I did was watch the DVD once, apart from again with you today, and then I kept referring to the book, which has got all the same points and a little bit extra, actually, in the book, all the scripting, everything else, and I kept referring to that and was able to just leave that at the side of the bed over a couple of days. And I felt like I digested the project really well in this way.
Hands-on.
So I just thought that was really good to have a DVD and a book, and I'm thinking of doing that with one of my projects in the future now, because that is really good. How much are you going to give it? Now, bearing in mind, on the Wizard product review, if you're going to try it and you're going to present this and this has inspired you to try it, you have to give it over 90%. If it's pretty terrible, you'll be down in like the 50s or the 40s.
Well, no, I think it's a good effect. It doesn't suit my style.
Well, this is the thing for you.
Yeah, for me, it doesn't suit my style. But if I was just a general magician, I'd definitely do it at something like a conference.
Yeah.
It gets everyone up together. I mean, it's not a magic effect as such.
No.
But it does feel magical because the way it looks is just so bizarre. I would probably give it 80-something, maybe 85%.
85. For a conference, I think this is unbelievable. I'm going to give it 93%. You'd have to change the script slightly for a conference, but I think this would get a great reaction from a conference crowd. But the nice thing is, with Steve's script as it is at the moment, you can easily make it work for a family audience as well. This is really good. If you're going to consider doing this chairs stunt, this is the best resource I've ever seen. We don't sell it. It's not available everywhere. Check the text. It's available. Right down there.
Down there?
Right down
right
there.
Right down there.
Oh my God, sorry, I'm trying to make this lines. A catchphrase. Screwed it up. On week two. John didn't even join in.
Yeah, John, seriously.
It's not available everywhere, but you'll find it
down
right
there.
Down there.
Right down there.
So John still didn't join in. Let's find it right down there.
Right down there.
Do you get it now?
Yeah, because it's in the doodly-doo with all the information.
That's right.
Yeah,
the
right diddly, down there.
The diddly-doo with all the information right down there. So, Jazz.
That's better, the diddly-doo down there.
Oh, my God, don't start. Can you just write in and say something better? Because I'm not
no,
winning this argument.
No, it's a new catchphrase. That's what it is. If you like that catchphrase, press like.
Right, so Jazz, I think it's fair to say you must be one of the most high-profile female magicians working in the UK today. Is that
Thank
fair
you.
To say?
I would say so, yeah.
That's
I
pretty
would
good.
Say so, yeah.
That's very arrogant of you.
You said it. I wouldn't want to disagree on your show. So.
That's perfect. Can I ask, what sort of work do you do as a professional magician? What do you specialise in these days? We'll talk about your TV stuff coming up in the next bit. But I just want to ask, when you're out there working at the moment, when you're doing close-up, what are some of your favourite effects that you like to perform? If you said top three effects.
Okay, well, when I'm working as a magician, I like things that are really visual.
Yeah.
Visual and have lots of moments. For example, I quite like Garrett Thomas' stand-up Monty. It's quite
Brilliant.
A nice routine, lots of phases. You can obviously change the presentation to suit you, and I quite like that.
Yeah, it's a great effect.
I really like a lot of Sans Mind products.
They certainly have a huge array, and it's always great production quality.
Mm.
I think there's a lot of things that have just come out, though, that you know perhaps weren't worthy of a release, but they do have some great ones every now and then, especially when they find an artist like Nicholas Lawrence. But carry on.
So it's mainly sort of visual, nice effects. I do a lot of card type things, like card transpositions and sort of things where they can sign the card and keep the card.
And
it's nice.
Quite gross, weird stuff as well.
Yeah, well, it depends. If I'm doing a high-end corporate, sometimes there is a note saying, just nice stuff, please. None of the blockhead or, like...
Eating light bulbs
or any other weird weird things that I like to get up to. But,
and when you're not doing kids' parties? What else?
Don't do... I don't think you'd ever let me loose on a kids' party. That's a recipe for a disaster.
Okay. Well, so we'll talk about this right now. This is John Bannon's new effect. It's a reworking of an effect popularised by Alex Elmsley. John Bannon's Sizzle. Can you try and synopsisise what happened in this? Because you see Liam does a live performance to camera, I should say, and then there's a performance at Magic Live. It's not like a gig environment. It's just like a straight-to-camera style performance. Can you describe what happens in this packet effect? You get all the cards with it. Can you synopsisise it?
How long do I have?
just try and describe the effect.
Okay, well, he's got an ace and some other cards which are all the same. So an ace and lots of jokers.
The jokers on one performance. They're jokers in the packet, but there were threes on the live
performance so clip. You've got one and then they're all the same. And what happens is they all have the same coloured back.
Yeah.
And then using this one different card, so using the ace, he calls it a problem solver or a solution solver. And he can use that to change the back, the colour of the backs of the cards to the same colour.
I'm glad you're doing this, not me. Okay. I'm just going to watch you struggle and look like the friendly host.
Yeah, so he uses the problem solver to change the backs of the...
Makes perfect sense to me, yeah.
Yeah, it's making sense, Yep. So he'll go, oh, you know, this... They go, this joker's now green, and that's a problem because that's the only green one. But if I touch it to the ace, then they're all green. And it's like a colour changing routine. So I think he does like four or five colours.
Yeah.
And then at the end, he has like a, oh, but it's okay because I've got one of each colour. So it's kind of a colour changing routine with many stages.
Right. Did you like it?
Do I have to be honest?
Yeah. That's the Wizard product review.
I think his performance was really great, but I didn't like the effect because as a colour changing effect, I do think there are others on the market that I've seen which are get to the point a bit quicker.
A bit more direct.
A bit more direct.
I think...
he was good.
John is a great performer.
Yeah, really great.
He's a very skillful performer. He's a very likeable performer. But there's something about this that, for me... Mm. Just made it quite hard to follow.
I think that's what it was.
As an effect, and what it actually meant, and what was trying to be communicated to the audience. Is that fair to say, John?
Yeah, I struggled to follow it.
I was actually quite surprised. I do like a lot of John's work. The trick, I could see magicians sessioning at a convention, doing the trick, and somebody going, cool, that's really good.
But it was really nice to watch.
Yeah.
Like, the procedures of it was nice. It was very kind of, oh, this is really pleasant to watch, and his performance was really pleasant.
You kind of really need to be on it to follow what's actually happening. You can't just watch this in passing, like somebody casually at an event having a drink and half watching the magician.
Yeah,
you really need to be like, right, I'm following this, there's that card, I've seen the backs on this one. And at the end, I've got to tell you, when he turned over the cards at the end and it was the Royal Flush... It didn't sort of, well, the flush, but it didn't really surprise me. It was like, well, have I not seen those cards on the other side? I'm not sure.
Yeah, it's one of those routines I probably wouldn't do it close up.
No.
But if I'm sitting around later on and someone wants to see something and they're genuinely paying attention, then maybe.
Yeah.
But yeah, it is tricky to follow, yeah.
It is tricky to follow, and for the general effect to be communicated. Mm. I'm a little bit disappointed, but it's still, if you like the effect, you know, nothing's been hidden in the release. You can see the whole kind of performance there, and you get all the cards necessary to perform it. If you like it, naturally, you're not going to be disappointed with this release because it's very well produced, naturally, by Big Blind Media. The cards are great quality. The teaching on it is second to none. It's whether you like the effect or not.
Yeah.
The thing is, when you say packet tricks, Jazz, and we didn't sort of talk about how we were going to link these two discussions, you've already mentioned, like, Stand Up Monty.
Yeah.
And it's like the two fall into the same category of the... but you know, just
I,
a few
I
cards.
Do stand up, I wouldn't do this.
Yeah.
I mean, I've changed the presentation of Monty and stuff, so it suits me. But maybe if you were good at storytelling or you had, you were good at that sort of thing, maybe this could become something really focal to your set. So it could, if you were better at explaining it, maybe.
I think. Like if you're. I think what I'm saying is the difficulty is when you've only got so little time with your spectators.
You need to.
You're going to choose what you're going to do. Something like Stand Up Monty is brilliant. So many changes. And yet it's very easy to follow for people. And this is a little bit tricky to follow. You'd really need to have the full attention of people. But if you practice like a show and you're working on like a show where you were like a card shark or something like that, I could see it fitting in really well. But on a commercial gig, I can't see it fitting in as well. Is that fair?
Yeah, I would say that was fair. It's not.
How much would you give Sizzle? And by the way, John has simplified a lot of the moves to make it a lot easier than the original Alex Elmsley presentation.
Well, it's a good package trick. It's a good production. It's not something I do.
No.
But I do like it as a product.
Yeah.
So I'd probably say maybe 68%.
68. Yeah, I'll go sort of 72%.
Yeah.
It's not for me John's best work, but it's a great effect, and if you've got the right environment to present it, it's going to go over well, but people do need to be paying attention. So, Jazz, not long, John, before she doesn't speak to us anymore.
That's it,
yeah. She'll be like, you'll be phoning and it'll just go to message. And that's all we'll hear from her ever again. Yeah, just, sorry, unfollowed. She'll be unfollowing you now. Because Jazz is going mainstream.
Verified.
You got the blue tick?
I did.
Yeah. Oh, God. Did I say blue tick?
She's got the blue tick.
What do you think he said?
I have a story about that or something.
All right, okay.
Well, it's quite clean. It's when I was a kid.
Do you want to tell it now?
Yeah, we were drawing birds in our class. This is a true story. Honestly,
okay.
Gentlemen.
Is it a good story, though?
It's a funny story. Anyway, we had to draw. I had to draw the bird a blue tip. Okay?
Yeah. The blue tip.
So I drew. Bear boobs, and handed it into my teacher. No word of a lie.
So you did it wrong. It was a tit, like, not tit.
And now you work for World Magic Shop.
That's right.
The creative side of the business in the production team. That's why, yeah. So, anyway, you're going to be on a show.
Yes, I am, yeah.
Okay, called...
Killer Magic.
Killer Magic. And it's not just you, is it? It's a team of elite young magicians. I hate you all. Right.
Yeah, it's,
with funky styles and young athletic physiques. So, I don't do that anymore. Right, okay. Tell us a bit about the show. Who else is on it, first of all?
Well, it's obviously...
Do you remember all their names?
It's Tess. No, I do. Of course I do. It's Damien O'Brien.
Yeah.
Ben Hart. Chris Cox and Dee Christopher.
Well done. Yeah, I was like, it's like Louis Walsh and that stereo kicks test there, where he couldn't remember all that. So, what was your first? Is this your first like mainstream TV? I know you've done web things for companies and that kind of thing.
Yeah.
But this is the first sort of time that you've worked on a proper show.
Yeah, for me.
What was the experience like?
Oh, it was brilliant. It was hard, very hard work.
Yeah.
Obviously, it took us 3 months to film the series.
How many shows is it?
Seven.
Seven shows.
Well, six parts and a special that was on in April that I'm sure, hopefully some of you caught.
So. That was just, wasn't it just on the web?
No, it was on BBC3, and BBC3 is staying on television.
Right,
okay. It is not going online.
And what channel's the show going to be on?
BBC3.
BBC3, so we'll look forward to that. And we'll let people know on the mail out as well when you're going to be on.
Yeah, it should be early 2015 is what we've been told so far.
I know why you've done that. That's just so you can strut around Blackpool, isn't it, and go, yeah, that's me.
We've tried to coincide it perfectly.
So you can strut around and go, yep, I'm the one.
No, I just like, hi.
I know your character. Yeah, that's exactly why you've arranged
that. Actually, no,
that.
I do strut, that's a lie.
Well, I know we've already spoke to your management, and it's like, don't say anything about the show and don't reveal anything, but is there anything you can tell us about your style on the show? Who you are as a performer, what they will expect from Jazz Vegas on Killer Magic?
Well, I like to describe my magic as beautifully strange. So what I mean by this is they're very visual effects.
Yeah.
So that's what I mean by the beautiful part, sort of visual, interesting, appealing to the eye. But the strange part that, you know, I've thrown in is I like things that are creepy and weird. Like, you know, like eating glass and yeah. which I did on the pilot, and have a variety of gory and wonderful tricks.
There's parts where you kind of cut yourselves open and
yeah I can't say too much, but there's a mix of interesting gory. I mean, it's the show is a post watershed show, so it is more edgy. It is less family friendly, so it's in my eyes a lot more exciting, so so I could do things that are a bit more outrageous.
What was the best thing about the whole experience, would you say?
Oh, there's so many good things. It's really hard to focus on one. You've got to
understand, for a lot of people watching the Wizard product review now, we have a lot of younger viewers, and a lot of people write in and say, you know, I'd love to be on TV. Mm. And, you know, what was great about the experience? And what was the worst thing about the experience
I think the best thing in the whole experience was working with the team so closely, because it's directed by Objective Productions, who are the same management as Darren Brown.
Yeah.
So I had a fantastic team. Yeah, they knew what they were doing.
Anthony knows his magic.
Yeah, yeah, great team. And obviously working with the other guys on the show was a pleasure. And you'll notice when you watch the show,
have you been told to say that? Is that true, really? No, that's one of those stock answers, isn't it? She's already been briefed for radio. You always say everybody else was a pleasure. What's the real truth?
No, they are.
What's that Damien like? He looks a bit rude to me.
Bit of a rude boy. Love him though. You can't not like him.
So what was the worst thing? You got to say something.
I don't know.
Early starts.
Yes, I think
Anthony,
it was.
Working
I think
hard.
It was. I had to, like, it was very hard work. I mean, we had 15-hour shoot days, and we filmed it in Glasgow in the cold. So I think that when you're filming television, there is a lot of waiting around, waiting for the lighting crew to set up, obviously we were always there watching the other people's tricks as well. So even when you weren't performing, you were there watching their tricks and watching them perform. So it did get very cold. So, but I enjoyed all of it. Like,
so
it was all part of the experience.
If people didn't catch the pilot, what was the rough sort of... how does the show play out? What's the concept?
Okay, well, the guys and I, we challenge each other to perform a trick based around a theme. So in the pilot, the theme was food. And then we all score each other out of 10. And then whoever gets the lowest score has to do a trick that we've called a killer trick, which basically has either killed or injured a magician in the past. So in the pilot, we did a bullet catch. So,
wow.
Yeah, so...
And the guy won by putting eggs down his pants. It's not much competition, is it, John? I could have beat that.
Yeah, but he did it with such pizzazz.
I could have beat that with a finger chopper. That wasn't much. It's like, exiting the pants, yeah, I'm the winner. What are you doing on that show? You should have just busted out the thumb tip and won it easily.
Sorry, I was just thinking, pants, busting out a thumb tip, it's not the two things you really want to put together.
Well, you like weird and strange. Put some glass down there as well to make it interesting.
I don't know what you're into, but...
That's Tuesday night. This is Wednesday on the Wizard product review. Well, it's coming out, Killer Magic, with the whole team. Give them all a name check again.
Damien O'Brien, Ben Hart, Chris Cox, and Dee Christopher, and myself, Jazz Vegas.
Woo. BBC3, early next year, just before the Blackpool convention. Don't forget to go up and get a selfie with Jazz, because she loves it. Believe me. She lives for it. She likes a crowd.
You're just jealous. You just want to
she
have
likes
selfies
a crowd
you're
going,
just jealous.
Who's that? Who's that?
Totally jealous.
Who's that over there? Oh, yeah, it's Jazz.
We'll do a selfie later, don't worry. I know magic. You're jealous. It's okay. I'll tweet about you and everything.
Will you?
Yeah.
Will you?
Promise.
Finally on this show, Split Second by Nicholas Lawrence, the guy with On Off and what was the
Space
other one? Space Shifter. Awesome. I've since tried that at an event. Have you tried it, John?
I've played with it at the weekend, yeah.
And have you tried the trick out?
I haven't been.
Right. I know you and your wife have been arguing, I know, but it's all right, it's fine. So, right, so, can you synopsisize Split Second?
Good. I really like it.
No, the effect. What happens? He busts out his wallet, doesn't he?
He takes out his wallet and he pulls out of his wallet a dollar bill.
Yeah.
And obviously he just shows the dollar bill. And then as he does a turny move...
In a split second,
yeah. The dollar bill, bam, it's turned into a deck of cards.
How good does it look?
Really good.
It looks awesome.
It looks amazing.
It looks really, really good. Multiple live performances on the DVD. It's literally like he comes out of his pocket with his wallet, he opens the wallet and then takes the note out.
Mm.
and you immediately do the change.
It's kind of for the card case.
Mm. It's kind of like a bowling ball production in that way, because you could have a very thin wallet as well and take it out, take the note out, and then it visually change. Obviously, it's not the only trick you would perform. You would then go into a card routine.
Yeah.
You get gimmicks in the box. There's blue ones available. The reds are in short supply. Is that right, John?
Reds are going to be back in.
They're coming, but they're on back order at the moment. But the actual effect, it's another winner from Nicholas Lawrence. There's really not much more to say than that. The DVD is handled very, very well. Herman's on this one. You like Herman, don't you?
I do like Herman. I like Sandvines.
Chris is in it in his beach wear.
He's in his beach on the beach.
Hi, I'm Chris, with all his shirt blown open like Copperfield from, Copperfield from the Bermuda special.
It's great. I love the effect.
The effect of Chris or the trick?
Bit of both.
She's on Twitter. She's the one with the blue Chris. Blue tick, Chris.
No, it was the
Get in
where?
Touch.
I just want to be on the beach.
With Chris? Bit of magic happening today on the Wizard product review.
It's the beach.
It's a great project. It took me by surprise. So I thought this is going to be a little bit obvious. But actually, when you see it, you see how it plays out, that you can, in fact, take the bill out of your wallet and change it. It will work with a £5 note, but there is stuff on there as well where you can adapt pretty much any note for different objects like gum. But the best effect is with the £5 note changing into the deck of cards. And it looks really, really good.
It does look really good.
And you won't have to change a £5 note too much. And yeah, you might ruin a £5 note while you were setting it up, but
yeah,
it's worth it.
It is worth it. Yeah.
It's not an expensive project.
I mean, the only one thing I'd say as a girl. We don't carry wallets.
Oh, right, yeah.
So for me, I'd have to.
But girls don't matter, do they, in the magic world?
Yeah, they do. No, it's a thing. It's a thing. Like, wallet
I'm
tricks,
just to be
you don't carry. You're just trying to make the chat, you're just trying to get the comments.
Yeah, come on.
Yeah. No, I think
so. How would you
do?
Surely, if you were a creative magician, Jazz, you'd be able to solve this problem. How are you going to do it?
I'd get a purse that works the same way as a wallet.
Well, there you go. Weren't even worth mentioning it, was it, John?
I'll have to find one.
Just wanted to get it in that I'm a girl in the magic world.
No, I don't
monopolized by men.
No, I don't think it matters.
You've got a chip on your shoulder
really
or something about
matter.
This.
No, it really doesn't matter. See, this is the thing. I don't think it makes a difference whether you're a girl or a guy or whatever gender you want to call yourself. It's what you do and how you present it. So it's about personality, not plumbing. The fact I'm a girl doesn't really make any difference apart from the fact I can get away with doing maybe more feminine tricks. But as a whole, I don't think it really matters. I think a lot of weight
still
is put on something that shouldn't be.
Still a master of magic, whatever happens. That's awesome.
Indeed.
Jazz, thank you very much for joining us. How much are you going to give, split second, before you go?
I'm going to give it 94.
94%. I'm going to give it 93%.
Woo!
A little bit less, because I didn't like Chris in his beach wear.
I'm just jealous.
But
he's on the beach.
Yeah, I'm just jealous of Chris, full stop. That's it, really. He's young, good-looking. I hate his guts. That's it this week for the Wizard product review. We'll see you next week. Thank you very much. Jazz Vegas,
bye.
The star of Killer Magic. Me and John will make all that applause between us. Try and make it sound like Steve Wright in the afternoon.
Crazy.
See you next week. I'm Dave.
I'm Jazz.
See you next week. Hi guys, I just want to share another performance sort of concept for Mystery Solved. A few people have already written to me and said how great it is for mentalism applications. And I noticed a couple of people on the forums saying although it was great for card to box, they thought it was a little obvious for sort of spectators watching that if you're putting a card in a clear box and leaving it there, it might make it a little bit obvious what's going to happen at the end of the trick. So rather than see this as a negative, I thought I'd actually use this in my creative process, and I think I've kind of come up with something that works really, really well at tables, especially if you use a younger volunteer. I've used it at a couple of weddings, and I just want to share it with you.
What I do at the start of the routine is I tell the person immediately to my left, like I say, normally somebody a little bit younger, because you can have fun with them, telling them to look away and that they can't see what you're about to show everybody else. And you clearly show everybody a blank face card with a regular back that has the words your name on. But you tell everybody to be quiet and stare at the card. And then you clearly put the card in the box in the usual mystery solved way and leave that box in full view. And then you can really play around with this with your patter. You can really have fun with this, because you could say to the volunteer, I'm going to get you to write your name on a card. And people are watching it and they can almost see the end of the trick, that it's just going to be a gag. You continue to do your routine as normal, as I described on the Mystery Solved DVD. I quite often put the card under the box, the deck under the box, a la James Brown. And then at the very end of it, I get them to put one finger on top of the box or their hand on top of the box. And I announce to everybody, wouldn't it be amazing if the card with your name on was actually in the box? And of course, everybody's creasing up in the audience. And when you tip it out, it's a complete shock, because the whole thing's kind of backfired. But then you've got this really great moment that I'm really enjoying, where you turn back to the person that signed the card and you say, this is a really interesting thing, because I showed everybody that card before you even signed it, and that card had your name on. And everybody confirms that, and they actually start to become part of the magic as they continue to tell the story of how they saw the card with the person's name on, apparently, before the trick even started. And they enjoy the performance even more, and the magic kind of lives on long after you've left the table. It's great fun. You're welcome to use it if you like.
It's like Back to the Future, but